his computer. Okay, praise God. Tonight is January 25th, 2023, and this is New Beginnings 2, Step Number 4 at Consuming Fire Teaching and Deliverance Ministries. And my name is Doris Sorrell. I'm going to stop the share just for a second. I'm Doris Sorrell, the pastor at Consuming Fire, and we're in step number 4. And that is, again, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. This step is very interesting because it causes us to look at ourselves. Then next week, when we go to step 5, it kind of this works together with step 5. They say that step 5 is probably the most difficult of all the steps to face, but it's also the one that provides the greatest opportunity for growth. So step 4 is closely related to step 5. And step 4 is where we look at ourselves. We've been busy in our addictions. We always turn the eye and the blame on somebody else. I'm like this because of somebody in the past. And that might've been true at one time, but we have to learn to look a different kind of way. We got to look at us, especially when we get of what I call of age. I'll give you an example of someone I knew that was abused, but when she got to, and so she had this low self-esteem and all. And then when she got to 18, I told her, look, I don't care what they've done to you. Now you are accountable for your own behavior. So stop victimizing yourself. Let them folk go. In other words, I mean, forgive and move on. You're in control of your life now. They don't have nothing over your life. You're in control. So that's what this step does. It causes us to look at ourselves and stop blaming other people. So we're now going to go to the PowerPoint on, okay, praise God, to PowerPoint and look at step number 4 in New Beginnings 2. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. So here we have it on PowerPoint. Someone, just help, please. Deaconess, please make sure, whoever that is. Okay, so New Beginnings 2, step 4. We made a searching and fearless moral inventory of who? Ourselves. Searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. So the old you is always ready to blame someone else. And look at him popping up there. He got that little battering thing. Look at the red eyes. His hair is ready to blame somebody else. Amen. But the new you has stopped blaming others and is learning how to examine their own self. So here we got Inspect the Gadget. Stop blaming others. Look at yourself. See that microscope is turned into their own self. Stop pointing the finger over there. Point it to yourself. So that's called inventory. So take an inventory. This is another Habakkuk 2 and 2 where you're going to write something down and you're going to make it plain. So here comes another Habakkuk 2 2, except this time you're not writing your dreams and visions down. You're writing, you're taking an inventory. So the difficult task of writing our feelings down, rooting them out and facing them. We have feelings of low self-esteem, anger, fear, whatever it is, whatever these feelings have done, they've made our lives unmanageable. Feelings like resentment, fear, anger, and even hatred. It keeps us sabotaging our life and relationships. We can get into a new relationship and bring baggage in there from some old relationship. So instead of finding fault in others, it's time to search within ourselves and find the root cause, face it, and deal with it. So that process, as Sister Pam was saying, it's a process. It begins with facing our own self. We have to face our resentment, face our fear, face our anger. Start writing down, and you just got to write it down. See, you're not doing it if it's just in your head. You got to write it down. That's what the inventory is. Written, something written. So step four is a written inventory of our feelings. It's difficult because it makes us face the very thing that made us hide in the first place. Remember denial? We just didn't want to face what it was, you know, whatever happened to us. You know, something made us feel bad about ourselves. And so we went into denial. But denial only lasts for a little while. And then you have to use some substance or something to cover it up, you know. But we come out of that. So our feelings, we have to look at our feelings. And sometimes that's hard to do. And we have Christians that say we're not supposed to go back. No, I'm going to show you where God said you need to deal with your feelings. Amen. I'll show you in the Bible. Everything I do is in the Bible. So we have to deal with our feelings if we're going to go forward. So we have to look at what it was that caused us to have so much pain. Where did these emotional feelings like resentment, fear, anger, hatred, all the low self-esteem, they all have an initial source. It came from somewhere. The problem is that long after the initial source has been removed, the feelings keep popping up. And that's what keeps ruining our lives and relationship. So it could be something that happened to you in childhood. And so now you have this, somebody hurt you or something. And so that brought you anger and frustration. And here you say you want to go to school, but you always get in trouble and stuff because you're bringing this everywhere you go, you're bringing it into relationships and everywhere. You know, until you face what happened when you're a child and forgive. Now we're going to do a whole step on forgiveness, but you can bring forgiveness in anytime because that's what it's all about. Forgiving, not just them, but yourself. Amen. And so you have to learn how to forgive people and let them go. Otherwise, they're going to keep victimizing you, but they've been going on about their business. You're the one that keeps victimizing yourself by not allowing yourself to be free. So this is where you have to trust the process. Remember that step number one, we came out of denial and admitted that we were powerless over our addictions and bondages. Our life had become a mess. Step number two, we realize that God is able to restore us to sanity. He really able. He's the God of all flesh and nothing. Nothing is too hard for him. Step number three, we decided to turn our will and our lives over to God as we understood him. And now step number four, now comes the even more difficult task of writing our feelings down and facing them. And so that's what's called, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of who? Our enemies, the one that abused us, the one that did whatever? Nope, just ourselves. Because those people that went on about their business, some of them in the grave, you know, let them folk go. Who knows where they are? But you're the only one that can keep them victimizing you. That's what I call a victim mentality. Give up the victim mentality and look at yourself and stop sabotaging your own successes in your own life. That's what happened to me. I would get to a point in my life to where things, let me come off the PowerPoint just for a second. I want to say this face to face to y'all. This, I didn't realize what I was doing, but when I was a young woman, and I think this probably was even before I was born again. I'm 73 now, again. I was born again at 34. But I would get to a place, and I come from very low self-esteem because I come from a dysfunctional family. And I would get to a place in my life where I would just almost made it. And I would, I'm not kidding, I would do something to sabotage. I did it. It was me. But I didn't realize what I was doing until one day I realized I could do that. I had to look at myself. I did it. I sabotaged my own self. And I did that for many, many, many years. And now, you know, I just let God, wherever you want to take me, Lord, take me, because I'm so over that low self-esteem. I'm so over that. But you have to become aware of how the human psyche works. You know, the human psyche is a soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions. These are emotional things. So what you're going to be writing down are your emotions. And you're going to look back to where you first felt them, shame, blame, all kinds of things, anger, and you're going to deal with it. You're going to deal with it. But this step is just about writing them down. Amen. We'll deal with them next step. But this step is about getting them out of you and on paper. And because they're so sensitive and so self-revealing, we're not even asking you to share them in group next week, because they could be that. I mean, say some of you maybe perhaps were raped. I wouldn't ask you to share that in group, but there were some feelings that came with that. There were some feelings that came with that. Amen. And so, so anyway, your feelings, you have to deal with them. You have to deal with them. And the way this step is to write them down. Okay, so we'll go back to the PowerPoint. Amen. Now let's see, where were we? Okay, so that's all this step is. So writing your list, it has to be searching and fearless, because it will bring up how you felt when certain things happened to you. Feelings such as fear, resentment, and anger are learned. They're learned behaviors. And if they're not dealt with properly, they will follow you and sabotage your life and your relationships all the days of your lives. This is called root cause. And so what we're doing is getting to the bottom of our feelings. So writing down your emotional response to the things, this is what we want you to do, that happened to you as far back as you can remember. This is a good way to get your feelings out into the open so you can deal with them. As long as they are hidden, they will keep popping up over and over again. Get them out. Amen. You could start your list something like this. I remember when this, you can name a thing, happened, and it made me feel this way. Our reaction to the things that happen to us is very important. It really is. So how we react to things is what makes the difference between being a victim or an overcomer. In this program, you will learn how to deal with feelings and how to be proactive versus reactive. But for now, we're just making a list, not so much at looking at what happened, but our reaction to it. So we have to learn how to be proactive instead of reactive, because now something could happen to you, just react. We got to stop that. So we have to learn how to be proactive. And proactive is, we're not always reacting to what things that we, you know, it's kind of like growing up. When I was a child, I thought as a child, I understood as a child, and I did childish things. But when I became a grown man, I put away childish things. Like I told the 18-year-old, you're 18 now. What they did, you got to let that go. You're the only one. You're in control of your life now. So let them people go. They probably going on about their business anyway. Ain't even thinking about you. And you is keep victimizing yourself. And that's what I call a victim mentality. We got to let that go in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And so let's go to the next slide. Hallelujah. So we're just writing it down. Writing your lips. I'm just going to tell you now, it's going to be painful. When you look back at some things that happened to you, and so this is your personal list, and it will have things that may be too painful to share with others. This is not for group. It's only for you. Unless you, next week, if you want to share something next week, I mean, that's fine. Sometimes those things can be liberating, but you're not required to bring any of this list to your homework. This is just something for you to write down and look at. Now, once you write them down, it's very possible you may need to contact your sponsor. I'm your pastor, so I'm your sponsor. for you, Eddie, it could be your wife, and there may be something you might not want to share with your wife, or something you just want to take to God to help you deal with the feelings, because feelings are real. They're real, and they have to be dealt with. Amen. And so in 2 Corinthians 13 and 5, I'll show you where it says examine. People say, Christians, we're not supposed to go back forgetting what's behind, but you keep on messing up. Like Sister Pam said, that people are, they love the Lord, but they keep on messing up because people told them, forget what's behind and go forth. No, you need to deal with what's in you. Amen. So how do you do that? You examine yourself. Let's go back and look at this. See all here on the right, the new you. He stopped blaming others, stopped being victimized by them. They went on about their business. So stop self-victimizing yourself, because you're your own worst enemy now. Stop blaming others and learn how to examine your own self. That's what the word of God says. Examine yourself and know ye not your own self. Amen. Write this mess down so it won't pop up anymore. I'll tell you one way I did that. Something happened recently. I'll say maybe about the last 2 months. And well, let me just get off the spare so I can laugh about this one. Something happened. I can't even tell you what it was. But I remember telling my husband, I went to the refrigerator and got me something out of there. I don't know what it was, but I told my husband, I'm comfort eating and I know it. I just said, I know what I'm doing. I'm comfort eating. And I am fully aware of it. I wasn't proud of it. But, you know, we have to be aware of these things. I wasn't hungry. It just something happened. And I went to the refrigerator, made myself feel better. But see, that's what I'm talking about. We have to become aware of these things. So I can't keep reacting to if something happened. I'm running to the refrigerator every time. They call that comfort eating. Now let me go get me some macaroni and cheese. Ooh, that's some good comfort food, y'all. I'm just going to tell you, I really like some macaroni and cheese. It satisfies me. You can do whatever you do, but see, who am I hurting? Nobody but me. So that's just an example. That's just a tiny example. So we're going to go back here and let's see, where are we? We're right here. Okay, praise God. Amen. So write your list down. So God says, you know your own self. Write it down. Amen. And then confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another that you may be healed. So if you bring something to me, I've got one reason for you to bring it to me so that I can pray for you. And God says the next step is that you may be healed. You can't just confess to just anybody. Listen, you can't tell just anybody. You can't confess your faults to just anybody, because somebody will take it and talk about you and put your business in the street. That's why it's good to take it to a pastor if you have one, for they can pray for you. Everybody can't pray. So whenever you confess your faults to somebody, it's so that they can pray for you. And the bottom line is that God can heal you. See, when you get it out of you, God can heal you. That's his desire. He wants you to be healed so that every time something happens, you ain't running to the refrigerator to get comfort. You're running to him. Amen. So your list also needs to be based on a set of values or morals. As Christians, we base our morals on what God says. We cannot base our morals on what we feel. You know, well, I feel like I'm right. I feel like they did this to me. Because we have a nature that's tainted by sin. You know, I feel privileged. What do they call it? Not privileged, but something like that. Because they done that to me. You just don't understand what they did to me. Well, if I told you what they did to me, you'd probably be shamed. So we don't even want to go there. The things that God, when God delivers, he delivers. It's like it never even happened. So we can't base our morals on what we feel, because we have a nature that is tainted by sin, which gives us a distorted view of what is right or wrong. In that case, my right may be your wrong and vice versa. But the word of God, it never changes. So here's what God says. We all inherited a sin nature and a distorted view on morality. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All. Amen. Romans 3:23 says that. Even the person or persons that victimized you, They did it because they sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everybody. It took God to point out our sins. Let's go to John 15 and 22. God pointed out our sins. And because some people out there think they're not sinning, and they are, but God is God's word that points out our sins. John 15 and 22. Jesus said to the world, if I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin, but now they have no cloak for their sin. So some of the things that we did, we just try to cover it up when we didn't have no part in, which we did. We had some part in it, but we have no cloak. We don't want the cloak for our sin anymore. We just want to fess up that it's us. You know, forget the people. Forget, this program is about us. This program is not about anything anybody else did to you. We're getting ourselves free. Now go with me to Proverbs 14 and 12. We're getting ourselves free. It's kind of like leave them people where they at. If they still victimizing people, that's their business. But, you know, we're not going to let them victimize us anymore. They gone and we still being victimized. A victim mentality. That's got to go. Proverbs 14 and 12. It says here, there is a way which seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So holding on to all these feelings, it leads to death. You can't, even though you are a Christian, you love God, but you can't go on, you can't go forward until you deal with all this stuff. So you write it down. So we all inherited shame, blame, fear, resentment, and stupidity from Adam and Eve. We inherited that. That was part of our inheritance. You'll find that in Genesis 3, 1 through 24, and Genesis 4, 1 through 14, Jeremiah 4, 22, and Romans 1, 22. So when you read in Jeremiah 4, 22, let's go there, Jeremiah 4, 22. Because in Genesis 3, when the devil told Eve that she was going to be wise and she believed it. And then I asked people, so let me ask y'all now. Well, let's go to Genesis first. Three, let's look, let's take a look at this. We have time. Genesis 3. And I want to show you something. Then I want to ask y'all a question. I don't want Deaconess to answer or Sister Nona because they know the answer. But Genesis 3. And verse 6. Sister Pam, could you read Genesis 3, verse 6?
Yes, ma'am. Verse 6, 3 and 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
Okay, so here's the question. We're all reading the book here where the devil lied to her and told her all this, that, and other. You're going to be like gods instead of other. And so she saw that this is good. It's a pleasant, it's good for to eat, and pleasant to the eyes, a tree to be desired to make one wise. So she took it and ate, and then gave it to her husband. He ate because he wanted to be with her. And so the question is for Sister Pam, for Brother Eddie, and for Sister Vicky, did they become wise?
Well, they became, I don't know whether or not they became wise in the sense of, when I think that word wise is mean, in the area of, how can I put it? I'm trying to explain. Knowledgeable of what was going, you know, knowledgeable of good and evil kind of came. I don't know. I'm trying to see.
Okay,
I'm
not so let me help you out by just
okay.
A yes or no answer.
Okay.
Or you can say, I don't know. That's fine. Okay. So a yes, I don't know, or no. Did they become wise?
I don't know. I'll just say, I don't know.
Okay, that's a good answer.
Okay.
Brother Eddie, did they become wise?
I'm gonna say that's kind of hard.
Yes, no, or I don't know.
I don't know. Okay, I go, I don't know.
Okay. Y'all know this is a trick question. This, y'all ain't falling for that.
It's a trick one.
It is. It's a trick one. And you'll see why. Yeah, you're going to learn some. And Sister Vicky, did they become wise when they partook, when they disobeyed God and took of that fruit? Did they become wise? Yes, no, or I don't know. Okay, so now let's go to Jeremiah 4:22, and we'll find the answer. And I'm going to ask Brother Eddie to read that, Jeremiah 4:22. Whenever you're ready, unmute yourself. Jeremiah 4:22.
Four and 22. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. 4:22. My people are fools. They do not know me. They are senseless children. They have no understanding. They are skilled in doing evil. They know not how to do good.
Okay. So here's how the King James, this is God talking about my people. He's talking about his people, okay? My people is foolish. They have not known me. They are sottish children. That means stupid. Sottish means stupid. They are stupid children, and they have no understanding. They are wise. So yes, they did become wise to do evil. But to do good, they have no knowledge. So that's what sin gave us. We all inherit the same thing. We were wise to do evil. We can think up some evil to do, even now.
Yeah.
Not us as born again Christians, but man can think up some evil to do. So they did become wise. They did. But they became wise to do evil. And even God said they thought of evil only continually, and then he destroyed them all. Y'all remember that. Now let's go to Romans 1:22, and this is actually talking about the first man and woman. I'm going to start I'll do 21 and 22. Romans 1:21 and 22. Because that when they knew God, I'm an Adam and Eve, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, because the devil told them they was going to become wise. And then verse 22 said, professing themselves to be wise, remember she said, she saw that it was a tree going to be made to make one wise, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. They became fools. So we all inherited the same stuff from Adam and Eve, the shame, the blame, the fear, the resentment, and stupidity from Adam and Eve. And so this stuff we got to dig out and put it on paper and let it go, you know. So even Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, had to take a fearless and moral look at his flaws and behaviors. Talking about emotions. So let's go and look at it in Romans 7. Romans 7. We had to take so people say we're not supposed to look back, but even Paul, who wrote it, most of the New Testament, he took a look back at his moral flaws and behaviors and wrote it down because it's written in the book. You just gonna write yours on a private piece of paper. So Romans 7:18 says, for I know, this is Paul speaking, that in me, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I don't know. For the good that I would, I don't do. But the evil which I would not do, that I do. Now, if I do that, I would not. It is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. He's taking a look at himself, not blaming nobody else. He's looking inward at his own self. 22, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man, the spiritual man. My spirit man just loves the law of God. But I see another law in my members, talking about in his body, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members, in myself, not nobody else, in me. Then he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? In other words, who shall deliver me from me? See, y'all see how we're not looking at other folk and trying to batter them on the head, what they done? We got to look at ourselves. That's all that this is. This step is writing down your feelings. Then he says, verse 25, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, he said, with the mind, I serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. So he said, I'm torn from the floor. I'm a mess. He's just the same as them women you're talking about, Sister Pam, you mentioned that they love God and stuff, but somehow they can't get over. They got to write down this stuff and get it on paper, get it out of there, and get it on paper somewhere. Let's see, Deaconess, Amplified. Okay, you want to read that in the Amplified, Deaconess, please?
Yeah, 18 to 5.
18
yeah.
to 25, yes.
Yes, good. It reads as follows. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot perform it. I have the intention and the urge to do what is right, but no power to carry it out.
Lord Almighty.
For I fail to practice the good deeds I desire to do, but the evil deeds that I do not desire to do are what I ever doing.
No.
Now, if I do what I do not desire to do, it is no longer I doing it. It's not myself that acts, but the sin, the principle, which dwells within me, I fix and operating in my soul. So I find it to be a law, the rule of action of my being, that when I want to do right and good, evil is ever present with me. And I am to its insistent demands. For I endorse and delight in the law of God in my inmost self with my new nature, but I discern in my bodily members, in the sensitive appetites and wills of the flesh, a different law, rule of action, at war against the law of my mind, my reason, and making me a prisoner to the law of sin that dwells in my bodily organs, in the sensitive appetite of the wills of the flesh. But oh, happy and pitiful wretched man that I am, who will release and deliver me from the shackles of this body of death? Oh, thank God, he will. Through Jesus Christ, the anointed one, our Lord, so then indeed, I of myself within the mind and heart serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin.
Mm-hmm. That's very clear. Thank you so much, Deaconess. But yeah. He said, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from me? Mm. He wrote down his feeling. He said, the thing I don't want to do, I do. And the thing I do want to do, I can't find a way to do it. So write those feelings down because they are hindering people from going forth. Now I have a song to go with that one there. And when I play this song, you're going to recognize it. And it goes right with this step. And remember what it is. When you're writing down your feelings, get this stuff out of you. Go back to, and I know, Sister Pam, that you're grieving. So you got some grief. Write it down, write it down, write it down. Get it out of you. Write it down. If there's something in y'all's past, like my past, way back, there's stuff. I had to write it down. Where did this come from? Write it down. Because it keep popping up. It kept popping up. Like I said, I told my husband, I know I'm comfort eating. I'm comfort eating and I know it. But see, I can't react like that. I got to be proactive, you know. But this step is just writing it down. We're not even asking you to bring it forward on next group, unless you want to. But you definitely certainly don't have to, because it's very private. But this next song, Deliver Me, Lord, Deliver Me from Myself, because all I do, I keep hurting me. I keep hurting me. Amen. And so this is your exodus. It means you're coming out of that. When you write this down, and then when we get to step five, let me just read to you what step five is. Step five is confession, truth, and integrity. Admit it to God, to ourselves, and to another human being, the exact nature of our wrong. And next week, you'll see how step five fits with step four. But you got to write this down. And that's your homework, to write these feelings down. You don't have to share next week unless you want to. Amen. And you don't have to share everything. There may be something. I have some things that I'll go to my grave. I have some secrets that I'll go to my grave with, because they're just too harmful, too hurting to tell anybody. I don't need to tell anybody. God already delivered me. And so I want to play this song, and this goes right along with our lesson here. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Deliver me from me, because all I seem to do is just hurt myself. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
He leads me beside still waters.
Jesus.
Restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right. And sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past. Hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister Leandria here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me. Hurt me, Lord, deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
say. Rescue me from myself, from my overthinking. If you're listening out there, just repeat after me if you're struggling with your past and say, let the Lord know. Just say, whoa. He wants to restore your soul. Just say, hey. Seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. I will hear from heaven. Break it on down. So it is. It is so. Amen. Now when we pray, we want to end that with a declaration, a decree. So I'm speaking for all of you listening, starting here, starting now. The things that hurt you in the past won't control your future. Starting now, this is a new day. This is your exodus. You are officially released. Now sing it for me, Leandria.
This is my exodus.
Yes.
This is my exodus.
I'm singing
this is my exodus.
To the old me.
This is my exodus. Thank you, Lord.
And I'm saying hello.
Thank you, Lord.
To the brand new me.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Muted, Pastor.
Oh, thank you. Praise God. Yeah, amen. So we got to stop hurting ourselves. So, Sister Nona, I want you to pray for Brother Eddie, Sister Vicky, and Sister Pam.
Pam told me to tell you, Pastor, she her daughter called, so that's the only reason.
Okay, okay. So praise God. And go ahead and pray for them, the three of them, and then we're going to come off the recording and Deaconess wanted another song. I got to find it.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, I thank you for Brother Eddie, Sister Vicky, and Sister Pam, Lord. Lord God, I thank you, Lord God, that they were here tonight, Lord, getting this word and getting this encouragement, Lord. Lord God, continue to bless them, Lord. Lord, I thank you that they're going to submit to God, resist the devil. He's going to flee from them in the name of Jesus. And Lord, you're going to give them the strength, Lord, only by you, Lord Jesus, to go on and do what you want them to do in this program, Lord, and then deliver from everything they need to be delivered. Lord, in the name, and just bless Mr. Vicky, Brother Eddie, and Pam this week as you go with them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen. And amen. Praise amen. God. So that song says it all. I just hurt me. So no more self-sabotage. And your homework is just to write it down. Write your feelings down, all those feelings, whatever they are, on paper, and let's get them out of you and out on a piece of paper. And then we'll do step 5 next time. I'm going to stop the recording and